As I said, if you answer 15 questions, your project will get through. So what are the defined phase questions? So step one is identify project CTQ. So what is written in a block is a typical Six Sigma language, while what is written outside the block is a layman's language. And if you look at it, both are same. So what is important for my customer? What is my purpose and plan? That is, what is a team charter? And then define process map. So how do the process look like now? That is what we call as an as-is process. Now, we'll not consider this step because this is also the part of an first tool of an analyze phase. So we'll consider that or a SIPOC in detail at analysis tools. I think the SIPOC is already being considered. So we'll go through that first. Okay. So what is important for my customer? So you must have seen this movie, and where he always keeps on asking, what is the problem? What is the problem? Define the problem in what is wrong. So teri samasya kya hai bhai? So that is what is exactly we are trying to find out in a defined phase. So the charter clearly, when we say charter, the charter is a main deliverable of a defined phase. So it clarifies what is expected of the project team, keeps the team focused. अपने को क्या करना है, what we have to do as a project is clearly, which मतलब if the charter is well defined, project is easier to implement. So let us move. Who is your customer? That we have to understand first. So there are two types of customers. One who looks at the effectiveness of the process, and one who looks at an efficiency of the process. And there is a third type of a customer doing the changes effectively and efficiently in a one go. This is a new era where adaptability also is being considered. But primarily, the projects are on effectiveness and efficiency of the process. So, giving you a simple example. You have a very large paper and you go to a Xerox wala, like is A3 type of paper or your degree certificate. Now it is not relevant to you because you have not gone through the degree. But if suppose you must have seen the degree certificate, which is long and wide. So if you go along with that certificate to a Xerox wala and ask him to give a Xerox. So the Xerox wala is not that educated, and he gives you a copy, and you find out that your vice chancellor's sign is missing. Now, when the vice chancellor's sign is missing, you again tell him, "Arey, yar, the vice chancellor's sign is missing." So the Xerox wala again says, "Arey, aisa ho gaya kya? So I will give you another copy." Now, when he has given you the first copy, is he effective? No. Because whatever the customer was wanting, he has not provided him. So after bringing it to the notice of an Xerox wala, he gives you another copy with some adjustment on the Xerox machine and gives you a very nice copy. And you see that the sign of the vice chancellor is visible and everything is visible. Now he is effective. He is effective. But at the same time, he is not efficient. So in this whole example of a Xerox wala, who looks for an effectiveness? The external customer who looks for an effectiveness in the product. And who looks for an efficiency? The owner of the Xerox shop looks for an efficiency. So probably at the second time when he gives you a Xerox copy, you are happy because he has charged you only 1 rupee. Or one copy, the money for an only one copy. So he is effective. But when he is becoming effective, was he efficient? No, because he has lost paper, he has lost the electricity, probably a potential customer because there was a queue at that place. So the next customer might have gone to the other Xerox wala also. So basically, the customers are of two types. They look for an effectiveness and efficiency. The effectiveness is looked by an external customer. Now, any product, somebody is making a polyester or a petrol or something like that. So they are not interested how many resources you are involved in. They are only interested for what you are selling that product. Ye itne rupaye mein mil raha, how many kg per rupees? And is it a value for him? That is what is being, and the specification given by you are correct or matching to his requires. That is what is looked by an external customer. But your internal customer, that is your boss or managers or the businessman, who looks for an efficiency in the process. So there are two types of customer. One is external customer and internal customer. You have to look, find out what type of customer he is, and then you have to address the solution. Once you know what the customer wants, it is very important. That is what is called as a voice of customer, and you have to convert that voice of customer into your controllable factor. That is what is called as a CTQ. So you are based on the voice of customer. It is important that you should know how that voice of customer is linked with my controllable factor, and you will improve on that to get the benefit to the organization. Now, if you consider, consider a cinema example, there is always a mismatch between the voice of a customer and a critical to quality or a controllable factors. Now, look at a cinema examples. If you want to go for a movie outside, not in these days of a COVID days, but earlier days, this is the example of a normal scenario, where if you want to go for a cinema, on what criteria you will select a movie? So it is a voice of a customer. It is, you are basically, you are thinking as a customer. So probably you will look at the reviews ratings for that cinema. What is the star cast? What is the subject? Who is the director? And type of the film, what subject it is. It is a romantic movie or thriller movie or etc. like that. Now here you are a customer. Now you are changing your role. You are a theater owner, and you are running a theater in Mumbai or Delhi somewhere, and you are on a holiday to Singapore. Now you are asking your manager to give you a daily report on what is happening at cinema. So what you will ask for? So if you are relaxing at Singapore, you want only a MIS report or a report that what is happening at my business, and the manager is giving, probably you will be interested in knowing how much was the occupancy, any safety or incident, what is the next plan, what is my operating cost for today, or how is the equipment operation status. Now this is what is a producer's thinking. And earlier was an voice of a customer. Now, if you try to match between that, there is a whole of a difference. The customer is thinking totally differently, and the owner's perspective to look at the business is totally different. So how do we match this? That is, how do we convert that voice of a customer into a real controllable factor, which is a CTQ, what we call a fun project. There is a tool available which converts the voice of a customer to a CTQ. The tool is called as a quality function deployment. Using that quality function deployment, what are the customer needs are converted into how it can be done, and then how is the real CTQ of your project, and you will work on that CTQ to improve your process or anything. Whoever the customer is, whether he's internal customer or an external customer, doesn't make a difference. So that is how generally you have to arrive from voice of a customer to a controllable factor called CTQ. So this tool is extensively being used in automotive industry to understand what exactly the customer wants. He wants a comfort in the car, he wants an average, or he wants some fancy look in the car, etc., etc. And then how do we do or accommodate that in our car? That is what is the CTQ. So once you understand your CTQ, we move to a charter. That is a basic document we prepare at the end of a design phase. So if you look at the charter has a 6 elements. So the 6 elements are business case. I have been telling you right from the beginning, what is the business case? Why I am doing this project? It has to be very clear in your mind. How it is aligned with the business objective. And once I understand that and I have a faith on that, if I improve this, my business is going to help or my business is going to grow like this, there is a buy-in come from the project team, and that is where it is very important to understand what is the business case of the project. Then problem or a goal statement. What is the objective? It should be very clear and concise and measurable terms. So it should be measurable. It cannot be achha tha, theek ho gaya. It should be measurable. Three, if my customer satisfaction index was 3, I want to improve it to 3.5. That is how it has to be for anything. It has to be always a measurable. That is what is the first emphasis of Six Sigma. Then benefits for the project. Is it a tangible project or an intangible project? So everything is money. But what is tangible means, is it reflecting directly in my books of accounts? Then we call it as a tangible project. Otherwise, improving the awareness about the process improvement of the employees is not a tangible project. It is an intangible project. After all, everything is money. But tangible, what is directly reflecting in my books of accounts, I can see, the finance person can see. That is also one of the beauty of a Six Sigma project. Is every project is validated by finance. The emphasis of the methodology, no other methodology emphasizes on this, but the Six Sigma methodology emphasizes on validation of the project or direct benefit which is achieved in books of accounts by finance. So whenever we in our organization do any project, there is always a finance guy who is affiliated with the project, associated with the projects, and when we are taking a baseline, he does the calculation based on his and then say that yes, these benefits are validated at the stage, and then actual validation also done at the end of the project. That is what is a primarily toll gate of a Six Sigma project. Then project scoping, this is also very important. What are my physical boundaries? What is in scope and out scope? Roles and responsibilities, who is my team? The generally team is selected on an RB model, that is approver, resource, member, and interested party. And what are milestones? What are my milestones? So when I'm going to achieve my goal and when my project is expected to be completed, that has clearly written down. Now, just look at an example. So it is a very simple project of reduce electricity consumption. So I have a meter which is fitted by an electricity board, and I want to reduce the consumption of electricity of my own consumption at domestic consumption. So the business case is very clear. This is my one of the main expense, and if I reduce that, it will be a directly saving to the money. That is what is my business case is. If I reduce my electricity bill, that will be my saving in the money. This is an example of an electricity bill. It can happen that you have other expenses more than electricity consumption, so you can attempt that also. But basically, it is only for you to understand how the charter can be written. Now, problem statement. Or problem and goal statement can also be written together. Or you can put that in a table also. So what is the unit of measure? It is very important. Now, generally, if I say about the electricity, then the natural thing which comes to my mind is rupees per month. Because I get a bill every month in rupees per month. So now, where you are actually working, you will be working on the units per month. Now, it may happen that you reduce the number of units, but the electricity board has changed the tariff and your rupees per month will remain same. So you have to understand that where my work will exactly reflect or where I have to really work. So when I am talking about the electricity consumption, the rupees per month is not important, but the units per month are important. So my approach should be on the bottom line. So I want to reduce the units, because if I reduce the units, if the tariff remains constant, my rupees will always come down. But if suppose there are certain changes in the tariff by the electricity board, it may not come. So I have to understand that where my work will exactly reflect on where, on what unit I am exactly going to work. That is your CTQ. Now, if you say unit per month, again, the opportunity will come after every month. So if you are doing some any improvement, you will have to wait for a month to get the result. And then unnecessarily your project will go on long, because again, you have to, if you want to do any course correction, you will have to understand, wait for a month, then do some course correction, then again for a month. So it is very, very beneficial to cut that into a small pieces. So the smallest unit you have to be considered. So it is number of units use on a daily basis. Now, if you look at the per day, units per day, then you will have to also fix up the time, what time you will take the reading. So yeah, it cannot happen that on one day you are taking reading at 7 o'clock, the other day you are taking reading at 9 o'clock, another day you are taking reading at 11 o'clock. So it has to be, when I see units per day, it has to be again clearly written down, from 7 hours to 7 hours my units should be this much. So when you write a problem statement, see on your screen the number of unit used for the period. So I am giving also a baseline period. So baseline period, January 09 to April 09, are average 45 units per day with standard deviation of 12. Now, why we generally give a period? Because the Six Sigma methodology all talks on the sample. So when I say I'm talking about this sample baseline. So when I say January, February, March, April, I'm expecting, I'm going to analyze this data for 4 months, but when I say this is a baseline, this is a sample, I'm expecting the population also represent the same. So I'm making it very clear in this case that my baseline is for January to April, and this represents the population. Means when I say 45 units per day, my other months are also overall 45 days per year, per day, 45 units per day, like that. Now, what is my goal is? My goal is to reduce it to 40 units per day by December 09. So it is very clear. So you can probably club the problem and goal statement also. The number of units used for the period are average 45, and my goal is to reduce it to 40 units per day by December 09. So it is measurable. You know the units. Now, when I say this period, it represents, the sample represents the population, that I have to ensure. Now, otherwise what happens generally, the projects are taken, many times I have experienced this, that the project is taken when there is a problem, and that problematic period is considered as a baseline, and we don't look at the other data, and which is actually not the representative sample. So this period has to be a representative sample of a population. Now, when you are saying about the problem and goal statement, what is written in the red line, see, do not write this will be done by doing, because as I told you in a slide at the earlier presentation or previous day's presentation, that you recall there is a funnel which was shown. So in a first phase D, we are focusing only on the why. So probably it will be done, how it will be done is excess. So causes. So when I am starting off the project, I am not doing any guesswork about the excess. I will be verifying my excess, but I am not doing any guesswork on the excess. So I am focused on why only. So the intention of writing define and intention or focus of writing define and measure phase is only on the why. So to recall, y is equal to x1, x2, x3, x4. So these are the causes. So I am not focusing on the causes. I am focusing only on the why. So coming next is a financial benefit. How much will be a financial benefit? So how much I will reduce? I will reduce my cost by 3000 rupees per annum. So that is what is a tangible benefit, because it will directly reflect in my bank account. That money will be saved. Now come on the right side, scope. So if you want to improve anything, there are two opportunities that you have. One, what is the process look like? So what is the process? Where it process starts and where the process ends, and what are the inputs which are coming to the process? So it may happen that your process is very fantastic, but the inputs coming to the process are bad. Suppose you are buying something which is the raw material is not good. So probably your process is good, your reactor is good, but you will not have that good product because your raw material is not good. So both of them, both of these aspects will be covered in scoping the project. So when I say the process starts with and ends with, it is a physical boundary of the process. Now, the in this case, where my process will start, my meter, and ends with the consumption of electricity at my home. So if somebody is taking a tapping before my meter, I am really not concerned. It is out of scope. And that is not going to change anything on my meter also. So I am least bothered about it. In a society, somebody takes up a connection before your meter, you are not bothered about it. But somebody takes a connection after your meter, you are bothered about it because that is going to change your meter reading. So this is what is where my process ends and where my process starts. It has to be clearly written down. Suppose I will give an example of how will you define a lunchtime? So there are various ways to define a lunchtime. Somebody will say, I leave my working desk and come back to the desk is my lunchtime. And somebody will say, I enter the canteen and come out of the canteen is my lunchtime. Both the definitions are correct. But where exactly you are considering the Y as, that has to come clearly in your charter, that where my process starts and where my process ends. Now, what is in scope? So it is obvious I am talking about an electricity bill and there is a festival season or Diwali season coming up. So I know during the Diwali season, my units per day consumption is going to be more. So am I going to consider that in scope or out scope? So if I am going to consider that in scope, you can write down all days. But if you know for sure that you are not going to consider the Diwali days in my this project, so you can set it right as an out scope also. But if you are setting that as an outscope, you have to go at the baseline again and eliminate those days which are the festival days to have a real picture of a baseline. It cannot happen that you are considering the baseline data of an electricity consumption during summer where you are putting up AC on and then saying that in a winter I have reduced that consumption. So it has to be a comparison apple to apple. So you have to have that thinking when you are really picking up a sample during a baseline. And you can clearly write down that also when you are in scoping that, out scoping that. Suppose you are talking about some productivity improvement and finding out the parameters. Now, you know for sure when my raw material which I have taken is not in the specifications. Now, if that is not in specification, it is naturally going to hamper your productivity or production. So are you going to consider you want a robust process to be designed out of your Six Sigma project, or you are clearly going to say that it is no, when I am getting raw material with out of scope, I am going to outscope the project. So you can have that chance. You have to define that when you are writing down a charter. And the most important thing, when you are writing a title of the charter, that is the project, the project here is reduce electricity consumption. So the title of the project will always start with the verb. It cannot be optimize or study, etc. So the intention of your project has to clearly reflect in your charter. So it will always start with the verb, reduce, improve, eliminate, etc. Okay, so your intention of a project has to be directly reflecting in your title. Then we come to a constraint or a secondary CTQ. So this is also one of the typical thing which is emphasized in Six Sigma, the way it should not be done. Now, this is a project about an electricity consumption. So when I was analyzing, I understood that I am doing my clothes press at my home. So I came out with a bright idea that I will start giving those clothes to the Dobi. So will that reduce my electricity bill? Yes, but then my laundry bill will इंक्रीज. और इफ आई से कि नोबडी विल यूज गीजर फ्रॉम टुमारो, नेचुरली माय इलेक्ट्रिसिटी बिल विल कम डाउन, बट पीपल विल गेट फीवर एंड माय मेडिकल बिल विल गेट इंक्रीज. सो द वे इट शुड नॉट बी डन इज व्हाट इज कॉल्ड एज एन कंस्टेंट सीटीक्यू, और इट इज आल्सो कॉल्ड एज एन सेकेंडरी सीटीक्यू. सो इफ सपोज आई वांट टू इंप्रूव माय प्रोडक्टिविटी और आई वांट टू इंप्रूव माय क्वालिटी, बोथ आर इंटर रिलेटेड. सो इफ आई एम इंप्रूविंग माय प्रोडक्टिविटी, माय क्वालिटी टू रिमेन कॉन्स्टेंट और माय कॉस्ट टू रिमेन कॉन्स्टेंट इज माय सेकेंडरी सीटीक्यू. तो इफ आई इम्प्रूव वॉन्ट टू इम्प्रूव माई क्वालिटी, माई प्रोडक्टिविटी टू रिमेन कॉन्स्टेंट, बिकॉज मेनी ऑफ द केसेस इफ आई रिड्यूस माई लोड माई क्वालिटी विल गो अप, बट देन आई डोंट गेट दैट प्रोडक्टिविटी. सो प्रोडक्टिविटी इज एन कंस्टेंट सीटीक्यू फॉर क्वालिटी. सो दैट इज द वे इट शुड गो, एंड यू हैव टू क्लियरली राइट डाउन दैट एज एन कंस्टेंट सीटीक्यू, बिकॉज आई विल नॉट डू दिस और आई विल नॉट हैम्पर दिस एंड इम्प्रूव द सीटीक्यू. दैट इज वॉट इज द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट इन सिक्स सिग्मा प्रोजेक्ट. Then what is process impacted and what is the business why impacted? So what is the business why impacted? This is a big why which is written. So as an overall at an organization level, there are seven, eight or five, six whys which are very important for an organization. That is increase revenue, reduce cost, improve customer satisfaction, improve employee satisfaction, or reduce environmental SHGF issues, etc., etc. So, with that, where is this project aligned to? So that you also, this is related to a business case, but you need to understand what is a big why impacted. Then the team, you have to find out who is a beneficiary of the team. He is really a champion or a process owner of this year. Now, process owner, once you improve your process, you will be handing over that process to a process owner who is a beneficiary of the project. And there is a term which is called as a champion who will be administratively supporting you. Now, imagine a situation. You are working in an organization as a shift in charge, and you are one of the shift in charge or one of the engineer in the process. Now, you took up a project to improve the productivity of the process, and you come out with a solution after your analysis that the temperature of the reactor is to be kept more than 280 or in between 285 to 287. Now, are you, as you are also one of the shift engineer or one of the engineer in the process, are you authorized to tell to all the process engineers that you maintain the reactor temperature between 285 to 287? Probably nobody will listen to you. So who is that authority? The champion is that authority that he will tell the others that you maintain the temperature between 285 to 287. That is what is the role of a champion. The champion and the process owner may not know Six Six Sigma, but they will understand why you are talking so, and then give you an administrative support to implement a project. That is what is the role of a champion. Now, project timelines are also clearly mentioned in your charter. Typically, if you have a data available, the define will take only 1 week. If the data is available, measure will also take only 1 week. The analysis phase is very important, where you will find out the potential excess and then screen those excess and implement the action. So typically, if you look at a Six Sigma project, typical Six Sigma project, it should not be more than 4 months. So your action, many of the times there are hardware changes or some changes which are suggested, so it may take a longer time, but your analysis or study should get complete within 3 to 4 months. That is what is an objective of any Six Sigma project. Now, coming from an electricity simple example to an alloy example, where reduce packing cost. So it is very clear in a tabular form what is the baseline, what is the period of baseline, how much is the packing cost, and where I want to go. And if you look at a constant CTQ, if I want to, when I am reducing the packing cost, my market complaints for damage should remain constant. Now I will do something in a packing, and my damage complaints will increase. It should not happen like that. So the constant CTQ, the way it should not be done. Then scoping is clearly written. Then what is in scope, what is out scope. So now look at in scope. So what is in-scope? In-scope is reduce consumption, reduce unit cost by any changes in the design. But what is out-scope? The purchase negotiation for the cost reduction is out of scope. Means the market environment is changing and now the raw material is available very easily and you are negotiating with the vendor to reduce the price. So that is not a part of this project. So it is out of scope. So it is very clearly written in a charter that what you want to do, where your focus will be, where the process will start and where, how will you book the consumption. So when I issue the packing material from the stores, my consumption is booked. When I consume it, my process ends. If suppose I issue from the stores and at my shop floor, the packing material is getting damaged, now that becomes the part of this project. So why it is getting damaged? How can I avoid that damage? So it is reduced. This will reduce the consumption. So that is how the project has to be clearly defined as a charter. Look at another example that improving percentage prime production for LDP. So this is one of the project at Jamnagar. So my prime production is 95%. I want to increase into 98%. What will be the benefit? What is scope? What is out scope? What is in scope is clearly written down. What is out scope? Plant shutdowns and power dips. So any failures in the plant and plant shutdowns are out of scope of this project. So this is how it has to be done. And again, constant CTQ is also clearly written, production and customer complaint to remain constant. So this is about the quality. So it may happen that I will broaden my specifications and improve my quality. So it is not acceptable. This is what is a constant CTQ is. So I think the charter is very clear and it is very the charter is one of the main derivative of the define phase and where you really know the scope where to work on is very clear. And generally when you write down a charter in Six Sigma, of course all the phases are signed off by a champion and a process owner. So once you prepare a charter, there is a process which is called as a toll gate process. So toll gate is when we are traveling from Mumbai to Pune or Delhi to Agra, after certain kilometers, there is always a toll. We pay toll and go ahead. So like that, at each every step, when we complete a defined phase, we get an actual sign off from a process owner or a champion. That is what the actual methodology goes. Now, coming to a major phase, there are three questions in a major phase. Define the performance standard. What is the best way to measure? Then, can I trust the output data? This is about trusting the data. Means, whether I am sure what production quantity I am getting is really weighed on a proper scale, which is really calibrated. Frequently or there is no disturbance in the weigh-bend scale so that I get a wrong metric ton. So is the measurement system variation within limit? There will be always variation in measurement system, but is that within limit? That is what I want to establish in this. And the process capability, how good I am today. So again, how good I am today on the scale of 0 to 6. This is a capability of the process. I think your capability class is also covered. So probably you know how to calculate the capability. I will give you a concept of an capability, but not actually how capability is being calculated. If it is required, we can cover that in the next class. No issue. Just give me that information. So what is the data collection plan? Validity of the measurement system and process capability are the three main derivables. So what is the best way to measure? So you have to understand yourself that what is the best way to measure and finalize that this is the best way to measure and freeze that. And everybody involved in that measurement will follow the same system or will follow the same process to measure that. That is what is the measurement system. Now, if you look at define clearly the performance standards. Now, if you could talk about the yield, there are various ways you can calculate the yield. Even in our organization, various businesses, they calculate yield in a different way. So, one who calculates input to output ratio is also yield. And the other way is called calculating a production divided by production plus waste. Now, how you are taking this as an yield? You have to clearly write down that formula that how I am calculating yield and is it a right way to measure? Yes. You have to ask yourself this question that is it a right way to measure? And then you proceed. Then is my data discrete or continuous? So is it a continuous data or a discrete data? So what I'm looking for? So there are two types of data, discrete and continuous. So give an example. So you give a blood sample. And out of that blood sample, you want to measure sugar in your blood or you want to measure hemoglobin in your blood. So when you measure here, is a measurable, matlab sugar in grams or hemoglobin is a, this is what is called as a continuous data, is a major data. While a discrete data is nowadays COVID, you want to test out where I'm COVID positive or COVID negative with my blood. So it is, what is a discrete data? It either says okay or not okay. So that is what is a discrete data. It is okay or not okay data. That type of data is called as a discrete data. While anything which comes as a number 60.8 or like that, that is called as a continuous data. So what type of data it is? Now the discrete data gives you a limited information, but if you convert that discrete data to a continuous data, it will give you more information. Now you say, if I say so in a paper of mathematics or in a paper of kinetics relevant to you, 35 students passed and my passing marks are 50. So this is a discrete data, okay, not okay. So you say 35 students passed. Now to convert that into a continuous data, I will say percentage people passed. So I will say 80% people pass. So what does this feeling use you? The continuous data, I have converted the same data into a continuous data. The discrete data is only saying that 35 student passed. And now I am saying 80% of the student pass. So that gives you more clarity, probably how many people appeared out of how many pass. So continuous data will always give you more information. So it is better to move from a discrete data or convert any discrete data to a continuous data. Suppose I have got data of an defects, so continuous defects. So I'm doing some production and how many defects are there? So I will say 8, 9, etc., etc. So I convert that discrete data into continuous data, percentage defectives or percentage defects is a more meaningful. So I get an idea that how many total versus how many defective. That is what is more informative. So always try to bring your CTQ to a continuous data, which is more informative. Is the data collected from a system or manually? Is somebody noting down or it comes from an automatic system? So if I am doing any measurement system, so basically I am trying to find out the variation in my measurement system. That is why it is important if the system, I have a data from a system, advanced automatic systems, then probably my measurement system error is minimum. And if it is not minimum, then what to do, that is what is the major phases. Again, in any other methodologies, the major phase is not emphasized much. But in Six Sigma, the major phase is emphasized much to verify that my measurement system is perfect. So if you look at, you observe a variation in the process. Now, why measurement system analysis? Because I want to understand whether that is an actual variation in the process or that is a variation because of a measurement system error. Now, if suppose I am working on a variation in the process, total variation in the process, and out of my total variation in the process, my 50% of the variation is due to measurement system analysis. Will my work on the actual process will reflect in my project? Probably not, because my 50% of the variation is due to measurement system. So there is no point in working on the actual process. So I need to have a good measurement system analysis, improve my measurement system analysis, and then proceed ahead. That is what is an objective of a measurement system analysis. Now, when you are doing any, you are looking at any variation, there are two types of variations: actual process variation and measurement system variation. Now, we want to find out how much is this measurement system analysis, measurement system variation, and is that in a limit? There are again guidelines given by Six Sigma ki how much variation is allowed, and if the measurement system variation is beyond certain limit, you cannot really proceed in the project and you have to set right your measurement system variation first and then go for a project. So out of a total variation, there are two types of variation. One is actual process variation, which is also called a short-term variation, long-term variation. Means your process performance for a short time is very nice. So it is called as a short-term variation, and on the long term, it varies. So it may happen that over a longer period, your process performance is not good. Suppose, take an example, you are running a race, you are running 100 meters. So it may happen for a 3-4 period, days of a period, you are very enthusiastic, must have done something or had a nice sleep. Then when early morning you go for an 100 meter running, you probably are finishing it in 9.5 seconds. But for a longer period, your overall average is 10.5 seconds. Now it is lower the better function. And it is very important that your measurement system, your stopwatch is correctly measuring your timing. Now, when you say about the measurement system variation, there are two types of errors or two types of problems can happen. One is with respect to accuracy and one with respect to the precision of the measurement system. So, what is accuracy and what is precision? So, accuracy again has got three components: bias, stability and linearity. And precision is repeatability and reproducibility. So what is accuracy and precision? Let us understand accuracy and precision. So let us take an example of Sourav Ganguly, who was he is fielding at Long Lake somewhere, and when he is throwing a ball to a wicketkeeper or on a wickets, probably he will throw a ball in a haphazard manner. He is neither precise nor accurate. Now, if you look at an example, come to an example of a Yuvraj Singh. So Yuvraj Singh is also fielding at Long Leg or somewhere, but now look at his throws. He is accurate. Means there is no variation in his successive throws. But if you look at Jonty Rhodes, so look at example of a Jonty Rhodes. So he being a good fielder, he is always accurate and precise. So what is accurate is, there is no variation within, but as well as it is always on the target. Now, what is a precision means? There is no variation within your throws, but it may happen that you are not on target. Like earlier slide, you see, he has four throws. They are very close to each other, but not on target. So that is what is accuracy. What is precision is? Accurately on target is a precision. So there are other components also, which is called as a repeatability and reproducibility. So take on same example of you have given a blood sample and your sugar is reported as an 110. Generally 120 more than 120 is said as a diabetic. So when he is checking for the first time, he is saying that the blood sugar is 110. Now, in a repeatability concept, the same person is doing that same measurement again in the same environment like that. And if he suppose reports your blood sugar as 120, so there is a variation. Now, is he repeatable? The same person earlier showed 110, and again when he checking saying 120. So is this variation acceptable? And then which reading need to be considered, 110 or 120? That is what is the measurement system is all about. So it has to be repeatable. That variation by same person should not be more than 10%. That is what is an passing, the measurement system passing rule. Then the reproducibility. If suppose there are two or three persons who are checking that blood sample. So suppose X reports 110, how much Y reports and how much Z reports? So Y also should report same around 112, and the Z also should report 108 around like that. So different person doing same analysis, is that matching? And the same person doing it again, is that matching? That is what is called an repeatability and reproducibility concept. When we have a continuous measurement system, take an example, same example of a blood sugar. Now we don't have any accurate result, because how you are going to find out accurate? There is a third person who will come, who will check, who will say it is 115. So it is only on the precision. So what is the variation between the two? That is what is called repeatability and reproducibility. As generally in our chemistry analysis, our results should match with the expert's result. That is how you get marks in chemistry practicals. On the same principle, that is what is called as an uncertainty analysis, or what is the exact reading. So is that variation within limit? Is your answer matching with the expert's reading? Then yes, probably he will give full marks. But if it is not matching with his readings, then there is an error in the method, and you will be, your marks will be reduced. That is what exactly we are trying to do here. Then there is another category or another aspect which is stress on what is the resolution of the process. It is in Six Sigma language, it is called the number of distinct categories. So if you look at an 100 meter race, there is always a very narrow difference. During our young age, P.T. Usha lost an 100 meter Olympics race, or she declared fourth only by 100 seconds. So there was a difference. How much was the difference between third and fourth? Was 100 seconds. So probably point not.
Sir, is it so 100 seconds?
Hello? Hello?
100 second or 100 millisecond?
100 seconds, I think. I will have to check up. Probably you may be right, millisecond. But there was a very narrow difference between third and fourth. Now, why she was declared fourth? Because the measurement system was capable to distinguish between third and fourth. Now, this is also very important, that the measurement system should be capable to distinguish between the two parts. Then only you will say this is good, this is bad. Now, it is why we are measuring on the 100 millisecond or a second, because there is a very narrow variation in the process. Now, is it become relevant when you are running a marathon and you are counting 100 milliseconds? Probably not. So it depends on the how much is the process variation is. So if you consider the 100 meter race, there is a very, very less variation in the process. So your first and last are in a minimum So low and high are in a very minimum time. In that case, you should have a good resolution of the process. But same watch, if you are using for a marathon or 800 meter race, it is not just not required. So this is what is exactly required. Means, if I want to buy onion or potatoes, I should not be using the scale which is used by an Goldman or a sonar. So if I go and want to buy my gold, I will be using a different scale. So what is the sensitivity of the scale and why it is important? Because I will be doing some improvement. Now, when I am improving some process, after improving, will my process identify that it has changed? And whether there is a sensitivity, suppose my weight is 85 and I want to reduce my weight. And when I am reducing my weight, the measurement system is not capable to detect 1 kg or something like that. It measures only 85, then 80, then 75 and 70. Now, if I am doing something, actually I reduce my weight by 2 kilo or 3 kilo, it is not reflecting in my measurement system. So before going for a project, you want to really establish or you want to really ensure that my measurement system is capable enough and which will detect the change in my process, and I want to verify that. So this is about the measurement system resolution. Now, if your data is attribute or continuous, what are the norms? So if your data is attribute, the repeatability has to be more than 90, reproducibility has to be more than 90, and accuracy has to be more than 90. Attribute data means discrete data. Okay, attribute and discrete, one of the same. And if my data is continuous, if my measurement system variation is less than 10, it is very good. If it is 10 to 30, I really need to take a call. And if it is more than 30, I should not go for a project. I must set right my measurement system first. It is like a signal. So if it is more than 30, it is red. You should not go in the project, whatever it may be, because you have a measurement system variation which is more than 30, which is large, and it may happen that there is no point in improving a process, because it may happen that it will not reflect in overall variability, because the measurement system variation itself is 30, more than 30. If it is between 10 to 30, you have to take a call. It is an orange signal. Sometimes in orange signal we go, and sometimes in orange signal we stop. So you have to take a conscious call, because if it is suppose 20, and then you have to set up a new measurement system which is more costly, so your champion or process owner will take that call whether to go for that system or continue with this 20% of the variation. But ideally you should be less than 10, and your distinct category should be more than 4. The distinct category is nothing but the resolution or least count of your measurement system. So just an example of an attribute data. So you are checking something, you have produced something, you have produced a pencil or something like that, and there are operators who will say this pencil is good or not good. So you have operator 1, operator 2 and operator 3, and his operator 1 is try 1, try 2, try 3, etc. So just operator 1 has checked it once, and operator 1 checked it again. So if both of they are matching, 100%, that means operator 1 is repeatable. Okay, so that has been checked for operator 1, operator 2 and operator 3. So you can see on your screen that operator 2 has a problem of unrepeatability. Now when I say reproducibility, ideally the operator 1, 2 and 3 all should match. So the first yellow column, all should match. But when it is no, I have just written it no, and yes, it is yes. So it is only 57% times the opinion of all three matches. So that is repeatability within the operator, And between the operator is a reproducibility. So the reproducibility is only 57%. And if you, and how many times they are agreeing with the exact result means actual result or expert's opinion. Since it is an attribute data, we can have an actual result or expert's opinion. And are we going to say whether this is matching with an expert's opinion or not? But if it is a continuous data, you don't have an expert's opinion on that. So you match only repeatability and reproducibility. Now, based on that, if it is 42% only, this is an actual data of an visual inspection. So if my measurement system variation is 42%, whether I should go for improving a process, it doesn't make sense, because even if I improve my process, it may happen that it doesn't reflect on an overall variability in the process, because my measurement system variation is very high. So in that case, it becomes very important to set right a measurement system first and then go for an improvement on the project. So the third phase is about the capability of the process. So there is a Dabba Wallahs, which is a service industry which is very popular in Mumbai. So what are the Dabba Wallahs do? It is a service industry in Mumbai. So those who are not in Mumbai will have a feel of this. What does the Dabba Wallahs do? It is an unique service industry in Mumbai. What do? Collect freshly cooked food in lunch boxes from their residence and deliver to an office employee who is located on the southern Bombay. So what they do, they collect dabba or lunch boxes from their homes and deliver to the employees at the offices at particular time, delivering to their respective workplaces, returning the empty box back to the correct customer residence by using various modes of transport. Sometimes they go on a cycle, by train, by bus, etc., etc. So how many such dabbas are served in Mumbai? 2 lakh dabbas per day are served in Mumbai. So it is very important. As in part of a charter or a measurement or during a measurement system, what is your defect definition that you have to identify? So in such type of a service industry where Dabba Wala serving a tiffin box to the offices, what is the defect definition is? So it should reach to a right person, deliver on time. If suppose he is delivering a dabba after the lunch time, doesn't make a sense. Each time, and same dabba will come to the same customer or same residence, that is also important. So if anything is not fulfilled, it is called as a defect. So how many such defects or mistakes? Based on number of defects, the performance is judged, that is what is called as a Six Sigma. So what is the sigma level of your process? In short, the capability of the process. So how many defects in your process or how many mistakes are being made in your process? So Dabba Wallahs deliver 2 lakh dabbas in a day. So probably 10 lakh dabbas in a week. So defects, how many defects per 10 lakh per million opportunities? So if we are having a defects 9,33,193, we call it as a sigma level 0. And what is the best process? The best process is to have a defects 3.4 defects in million opportunities. So parts per million. So how many defects per million opportunities? So only 3.4 defects per million opportunities. That is what is the aim of a Six Sigma. And if you talk in terms of the yield, it is 99.9999%. So getting 99.4 or 99.98 is a 5 Sigma or a 4 Sigma. if you want to achieve a process to a Six Sigma level, the yield has to be, or defect has to be, so less that is the conversion is 99.9999%. Now, if you understand what is the background of N6 Dabbawalas, so the education of Dabbawalas, they are just 5 to 7 standard pass, speaks only local language. Then what is the secret of their success? Now, at what level? You must have heard this somewhere in the newspapers. The Charles, the Prince Charles has also admired these people, Dabbawalas. So they operate on 99.99. Even somebody say that they operate more than Six Sigma. So their education is only 5 to 7 standard. Speak only your local language. They even can't talk English or Hindi, something like that. Even then, what is the secret of the success? The secret of the success is not in the process. So the Six Sigma always emphasize the product by process. So the process of Dabbawalas is so nicely designed that product will automatically come. And the quality will automatically be maintained. So even the fool cannot even make a mistake. That is how the process has to be designed. So emphasis of the Six Sigma is to improve a process. So you have to focus. It has to be a product by process. Not by adjustments, not by administrative, or not by monitoring something. It has to be a product by process. So that is what is the thrust of N6 Sigma, that you have to improve or design a process to a such a level that product will automatically come. Now, very simple example. Have you seen any samosa wala or patata wada wala doing a quality control check during its process? Who has a thela on the roadside, etc.? So he never checks. Have you seen that he is eating a samosa or he has prepared? So he doesn't do any quality check, but he is very confident about his quality, or he is very confident about the consistency of his quality. That is how it is, product by process. So it has to be always a product by process. So Six Sigma emphasizes on product by process. So this was about the discrete data. So if you have an continuous data, so the continuous data, how many standard deviations you are able to accommodate on one side? That is nothing but a CPK also. That is an index. What is called as a capability index. So the ultimately why this methodology is called as a Six Sigma methodology, you can see on your screen that our aim is to accommodate 6 standard deviations on one side of the project. One side of the process. So whole objective is to accommodate maximum numbers of standard deviations. Now how can you achieve this? So when you are calculating CPK, it is what is specification limit and what is average. The specification limit is always said by a customer. So where you are from a customer requirement and how much margin you have. If you have a very broad margin and your process variation is very less, your standard deviation of the process is very less, naturally the probability of the defect is very less. So when you are calculating capability on a continuous data, you are interpreting about the probability of the event, and from that probability of the event you will say the sigma level of the process is this, and so on 0 to 6 scale. So the objective is to accommodate 6 standard deviations on one side. And it comes from the same foreign attribute data or destructive data. It is 3.4 ppm per million opportunities. So if you have, what are the options you have to eliminate those defects? It is about reducing the variation in the process. So if you want to improve the capability of the process, it is always, it is specification divided by standard deviation. Now specification is there is no control on specification by you. You as a process owner, you are not going to decide what the customer should specify. So the customer will specify in his own ways. For example, you go to stores to buy some shirt or clothes. So you will always specify your range. That is what is your specification. So the shop owner will not say you that I have only 2000 plus minus 20 or 2000 plus minus 200. If any shop owner says like that, you will not go to that shop again, because there is no flexibility. And when you go to the shop, you say that ki, I want a shirt with 1000 rupees plus minus 100. So the specifications are always decided by a customer. Now, as a process owner, you don't have any choice. If you want to improve capability, the only thing which is in your hand is reduce the variation. So when you talk about the Six Sigma, the people will always say it is about reducing the variation. So by reducing the variation, what you are trying to do, you are trying to improve the capability of the process. So if your process is more capable, the probability of the defect is very less and it becomes a more reliable process. That is why Six Sigma. Now if you look at the distribution, if you have a very high variation, probably your sigma level is 2 or something like that, which is shown on a pink graph. But as you go or as you reduce the variation, like you see a yellow graph, you have an less variation and your sigma level also improves. So it is higher the better function. So sigma should be more from 0 to 6. So and your defect should be less. So the PPM is defects. So 3.4 defects. So you are reducing the defects. That is what is the probability of the defect. And you know, the capability of the process goes up. That is how the sigma scale is. Now to understand it in a very simple manner. So you have a very wide car and your parking garage is limited. So probably you stay outside the car. So sigma level of the process is very bad. Now you have cut to cut dimensions. So probably if you have that type of a garage, you will probably try to park the car. But here the probability of the defects or probability of getting your car damaged are more. Now what is the attempt is, if your car is half the width of the garage, it will be always very comfortable for you to park your car reliably. So this is what is in a nutshell is, you should be comfortable and you should be confident and reliable for the defect. So your probability of the defect should be very narrow. That is what is the emphasis of an Six Sigma. So this is what is the major phases. So again, I summarize, what is the major phase is all about. The major phase, first question what we ask, what is the best way to measure? Is my measurement system, can I rely on the data or is it the best way to measure? Then secondly, is my measurement system capable or the variation in my measurement system within limits? So I try to find out how much percentage it is. And if it is less than 30, I go for a project. Otherwise, I have to set right my measurement system. Based on my existing performance or baseline performance, I try to find out what is the capability of the process. And based on that capability, now at this stage, again, you have a slide in front of you where Y is equal to F, X1, X2, X3. Now, all the focus of my define and measure phase was on Y. Now I have locked Y. Now what is my intention is, now I have to find out why this effect is And what are the factors which are making that effect? So I am now in a search of excess. And now I will check up which are the main parameters which will have an impact on my Y. And I will again, in Six Sigma, we control excess and monitor Y. So what is my intention again? I don't want to control Y. I will only monitor Y. I will control the variation in the excess. And if I am able to control my excess, my Y will automatically come if I establish that there is a relationship between this X and Y. Now, whole Six Sigma trick is to understand that what are my excess. That is what is called as an analyze phase, and it is very important phase. So how do we do that? That can be done using a basic quality tools, or there are some high-end tools also, which is called as an FMEA. If it is a lean Six Sigma, then it is a value stream mapping, then waste identification. Nowadays, there are very popular words which are saying as in process mining, digitization, automation, etc. But ultimately, it should all change the Y. Or you should be able to establish that there is a relation between X and Y. So let us start with the basic tools. So what are these basic tools? So when we are going for analyze phase, again, three questions. Identify variation sources. What factors can make a difference? Then the screen potential causes. What is the root cause? So there are so many reasons, but what is the exact root cause? So I will screen the potential causes and identify critical causes. And what is the relationship between that two? How can I predict the output? So I can measure that relationship, and I can predict that. Suppose that means, I increase temperature by 5 degrees, how much my yield will increase, etc., etc. Can I predict that? So let us start with the first, identify sources of variation. There are various tools. So these are the various tools which are used in analyze phase. Basic 7 quality tool, then new quality tool, then YY analysis, correlation regression analysis. If your data is discrete data, then it is binary logistic regression. If both X and Y are discrete, then contingency tables are used. Then ANOVA, analysis of variance. If my X is continuous and Y is discrete, analysis of variance is used. FMEA, then value stream mapping, concept of 7 waste, lean tools, or optimization like design of experiments. So we'll not go through all these tools because, as I say, there are levels: yellow belt, green belt, black belt. Probably these we cover usually all these during a black belt session. But basically, we'll cover for you the basic quality tools, YY analysis. I will also, being a chemical engineer, I will also give you a flavor of a correlation analysis and FMEA, and again, value stream mapping and 7 waste. So let us go start with the basic quality tools. So basic, there is nothing rocket science in all these tools. It is based on just a common sense. The methodology, whole of the methodology is based on the just common sense, but you have to have that structured process. That is what is most important. Measuring everything, establishing measurement system analysis is right. Establishing the relationship between Y and S, and means control excess and Y will automatically come. That you have to establish. So basic 7 quality tools. So these basic tools support different situations by specific tools. It is not like that the situation for a particular situation, particular tool is useful, and you will be using these tools. And unless you use one of these tools, cannot go for an advanced tools. So basically, in nutshell, in any project, you have to use one of the basic 7 QC tools. So, Professor Keiru Ishikawa always says, he's a Japanese quality guru, he has always said that 95% of the problems will get solved with these basic tools only. Only in few cases there is advanced tools required. 95% problems will get solved in these tools only. So at the scope of an yellow belt, we'll emphasize on these basic quality tools only. And most of the projects or most of the problems you are dealing with will get solved with these quality tools only. So let us start. So there are seven, and again the purpose of all the tools is different. So there are two tools, process mapping and checklist is to identify, then few tools for prioritizing, then for analyzing and communicating. So let us start with the process mapping. So I think it is nothing different than SIPOC. So you must understand what is the actual process versus documented process. What are the value-added activities and non-value-added activities, and process inputs and outputs. So process mapping generally goes at the three levels. One is macro level, then process flow diagram, and detail input-output worksheet. So when you talk about the SIPOC, SIPOC is at micro level. So if you look at the three levels, one is at a business level, that is helicopter side view. Then after the next step is, that is what is called as an SIPOC. Then the next step is at the rooftop or at the site. And third, which is called as an input output, it is at the micro level or operational level or each process step. So let us understand the process mapping at all these three levels. So when I say SIPOC, of course, it is with an increasing details. As you go on the ground, you will find the details, increasing details of the process. So how does the process look like SIPOC, or it is also called as an COPIS? So many in many of the literature like G, they always refer it as an COPIS. Why COPIS? Because they say that your thinking should start from a customer, so it is COPIS. But traditionally, the physical movement of the any process is like a SIPOC. But your business process goes on a COPIS model. Now suppose, how the business process? Now suppose Mukesh Bhai wants to have another refinery in India at Jamnagar. So going for a new process, going for a new business process. So what he will look for first? He will look for customers first. Once he establishes, yes, there are customers for a new refinery or new polypropylene product or new polypropylene plant or polyester plant, something like that. Then he, knowing the customer, he will also identify how much output or how much product they will purchase. Based on that, he will have a process. Then he will have inputs or raw material inputs from different vendors and the suppliers. So who will be able to give me this much of an raw material at this price will come last. So the traditional process goes from a SIPOC, but the business process goes from a customer to supplier. So mentally the process goes from a customer to supplier. Physically, the process goes from supplier to COPIS. That is what is a... So, there are various versions in the process. Next step is, once you have a high-level view of the process, then is an, how is the actual process? What is the concept? What is the reality and what is the ideal one? So, you want to... What is written on the paper? Or what is best you can do it in a process flow diagram. That is what is the second step process. Then third is what is actually happening, or what are the inputs coming to an each process. So what is input and output? So what is in scope, what is out scope, and what is the input making difference at particular step is important. So let us understand it by example. You will be able to appreciate this using an example, because if I say micro map, PDF and input output will not make you much sense. So look at the actual process mapping, how to make a cup of tea. You can have a various example like the even on the net, the coffee making is also available as a process mapping. So what is the first step? The first step is SIPOC. So at the center is my tea preparation process. What are the inputs which are coming to the tea preparation, and who are the suppliers, what is the output, and who are my customer? This is what is helicopter view. Now I am coming to a rooftop where I am actually drawing a process flow diagram. You as a chemical engineer must have seen the processes, and you always follow a process flow diagram. And this is how I make a tea, and these are the step-by-step processes how to make a tea. Now what is the third phase? Third phase is input-output worksheet. Now if you look at the input-output worksheet, what are the types of different types of outputs? So it is mentioned there what is the raw material, information, then equipment, infrastructure, human resource, SOP, etc., etc. So let us look at one by one. So in a tea making process, what are the raw materials? So probably the raw materials are water, milk, sugar, tea. Now the specification of the raw materials is very important. How much quantity to take for making a tea? Is it a pure water, or water has some smell? Now what is important when we are mapping a process, we are trying to identify, and will that factor make a difference on my tea taste? So why are you mapping a process? We are mapping a process to identify what are the potential causes, so that I can take them forward for an analysis, or using a next any other tool, I can understand, is it making difference or not making a difference? So what are these? These are all potential causes. Now if I say milk, quantity of milk, or a type of milk, cow milk, buffalo milk, powder milk, Malay milk, is it making a difference on my tea taste? Yes. So these are my potential reasons. And these are my potential reasons, I will take them to an analysis. And what I'm trying to do, this is not exactly an analysis phase, but this is starting of an analysis phase where you are trying to find out the potential reasons. Actually, the process map is a part of a define phase. So when we are actually defining a project, we also map the process, and at the same time we also try to find out the potential reasons which are on the top of the funnel. So what are these all? These are all on the top of the funnel. So these are the potential reasons. So the one purpose of a process map is to identify a potential reason so that we don't miss out anything, because we have to consider all the reasons. Okay. So like that, raw materials, then equipment. Is equipment making a difference? So if I use aluminium utensil or a copper utensil or a stainless steel utensil, will that make a difference on a tea taste? If yes, it is a potential reason and you can take it forward. Otherwise, you can drop that. Heating device like gas burner, electric kettle or kerosene, will that make a difference? Filter size or life of a filter, will that make a difference? If yes, it is a potential reason. So what is the purpose of a process mapping is to identify the potential reasons to take it forward. Now, if we go for a value stream mapping, etc., we'll also give a counting or number to it that we'll understand later on in our next session. But at this moment, for a Six Sigma project, when we are mapping process, we are trying to find out the potential reasons at each step. The idea is so that we are convergent with the process, because it may happen that a black belt is not from a domain knowledge. He wants to improve the process, so he has to understand the process. So once he understand the process map, detail input output, he will understand the process and treat them as an potential causes. So similarly, SOP, when to add sugar, how much time to boil, when to add milk, are of the part of the standard operating procedures. So are they making a difference? That is what is a question we have to ask. Now there is another type of an process flow diagram which is called as a swim lane map. when there are various departments and agencies involved in the process, it is done in a swim lane process. Now, why it is called as a swim lane? Because in a swimming competition, the swimmer swims in his own lane. That is how each function works in his own lane, and we make a map according to that. The user role of an user is identified in a lane, purchase in one lane, manufacturer in another lane, like that. That is what is why it is called as a swim lane map. So flow diagram for organizing a meeting. So basically, it is a tool to identify all the steps. Identify again potential reasons. The second tool is check sheet or a data collection plan. So it can be called as a data collection plan also. So when we say check sheet, what strikes to our mind? We have a list and we go on ticking. This has been done. This has been done. This has been done. This is not the only purpose of the checklist here. This is what is called as a data collection check sheet. So how does it works? So it is basically to simplify data gathering. So look at an example. This is one of the example of an garment making industry. So the garment factory is producing the shirts, and they want to understand the reasons of a rejects of their shirts. So probably they have three types of rejects, that is flaw, tear and mark. Now, if you look at the mapping or a data collection check sheet, you can identify there is a mark on the sleeves only, or a particular place. So, with the check sheet, data collection check sheet, you are nearer to the solution. You are narrowing down to the solution. Like that, you probably you will come out with the observation that why I am getting marks only on the sleeves, on the front side or on the back side, etc., etc. So that is what is the purpose of a check sheet. There is another example of a door paint. So car door paint checks. So bubble, run, scuff, probably where it can be. So probably you will say there is a clustering of bubbles at one place. So then you go and brainstorm. That is the next tool which is coming up. Identify causes why there is a bubble here, or probably do a Pareto like that. But the first cut is that you have identified one place where my bubble defects are more. This type of a data collection check sheet is being used everywhere, but this has been originated from entire industry to understand the defects of the molds on the tire. So basically, they started with mapping the defects on the tire, similarly as it is shown for the garment and door of the vehicle. So number of defects, location of the defects, machine-wise breakdown, causes of defects is a purpose of a check sheet. Then there is a third tool which is called as a stratification. So how stratification works? The stratification is slicing the data. Now in today's world, you must be analytics. You must have heard the one data analytics, etc. So the whole of the data analytics is working on the stratification tool. Entire computer or IT industry, where they say data analytics basically is based on the stratification. That is what is the slicing the data. So there are examples, what factors. So example, who, department, individual, customer type. What type of complaint, defect category, reason of incoming calls. Then when, month, quarter, day of a week, time of a day, where, region, city, like that. So basically what you are trying to find out, you are trying to slice the data to understand where my exact problem is. So let us look at an example. So this is an example of a late pizza deliveries. So for an overall month, this is a bar chart of an late pizza deliveries. Now for stratifying a data, it was stratified using a time scale. So how many late deliveries between 12 to 359? Actually it is 359. And how many late deliveries between 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. or 7:59? And how many deliveries, late deliveries after 8? So you are on the problem. So if you slice that data, you immediately come to know, yeah, my late deliveries are more during after 8 o'clock. So whatever the reasons, you are focused on that area now. So you will walk through the process after 8 o'clock. There is no point spending walk through the process for an entire day. So you are focused on the problem. So probably you will come out, there are less number of people available for delivery or preparation after 8 o'clock. We shut down few ovens after 8 o'clock, or 8 o'clock there are really number of people's coming, more number of people's coming up, etc., etc. The reasons can be anything, but by stratifying the data, you have understood where the problem is. That is what is the meaning of an stratification. Now let us look at another example where we are talking about the net promoter score. So what generally this concept is followed in the service industry. So you must have filled up the surveys many times where you have rated, answered any question on a scale of 1 to 10. So on a scale of 1 to 10, if you have rated 9 to 10, 9 or 10, you are promoters. If you have rated 6, 7, 8, 9, you are passive. And if you have rated 5 and below, you are detractors. So how does the net promoter score comes? How many of you percentage promoters minus percentage of detractors? So based on that, it is called as a net promoter score. It is very popular in service industry. What is my NPS is? So let us look at that. This is an overall example. How much is the net promoter score? So my overall net promoter score is 38%, not only because it is passive, but it is promoters minus detractors, it is 38%. Now, when I look at this score, there is always a possibility that how many 8 and what are the responses of 8, how many 6, so that they will slip up to the detractors. Now, this is what is I am slicing the data. So if I want to go deep, Reliance has got a very lot many locations. So if I talk about the overall 38 score, that is what is called as an overall 38 score, how I am slicing it location wise. So what is my net promoter score at Navi Mumbai, Patanga? These are the various Reliance locations where the plants are located. So from this, I immediately understand that my score at Vadodara and Dahej is very low. So I need to do something at these 2-3 locations, that is Hyderabad, Vadodara and Dahej. Now, this is location-wise stratification. I can also go what are the area-wise slicing, means aspects. Security, why they have rated low. In a security, fire, health, safety, facility, technical services, help desk or hospitality. So here it also comes out that hospitality is very low. Scores are very low. So if I map that both area and facility or area and services, I should be able to narrow down on few of the areas where my scores are low and then have an action plan based on those locations where it is low. Particular locations and particular area wise, my overall NPS will get improved. That is what is an example of an stratification. So I slice the data to understand where the problem is. Okay. The next tool is a Pareto diagram. Basically, the Pareto diagram is an economic principle. The name by economist Wilfred Pareto. He had a basic principle. He said that 80% of the wealth is with 20% of the people. which still holds. This is a principle he stated. He died in 1923, so he had this principle before that. And what he has stated years back is still valid, that 80% of the wealth is with the 20% of the people. Based on this economic principle, Joseph Juran converted it into a management principle, and he said 80% of the effects are due to 20% of the causes. So it is also called as an Pareto tool. It is also called as an 80-20 rule. So what we are trying to find out, the 80%, the punchline is identify vital few out of travel many. So the punchline is identify, you have many reasons. From those many reasons, you will find out travel many which are impacting most. So this is how Pareto diagram look like. It is also called as an 80-20 rule because there are two scales. One is for the number of defects and one is for an cumulative percentage defects. So cumulative percentage, we draw a line from 80 and comes down. And what are the reasons on the left, which gives us the indication that if you improve this, your 80% problem will be solved. Okay, so this is what is vital few out of travel many. Now, how to construct this diagram? So let us understand that. It is very easy, not rocket science, but it is very important to understand, because it is not only that key you understand the concept. You actually should be able to also draw a Pareto analysis in your project. That is what is most important. That is why I am taking you through how to draw a diagram. So there are various defect categories. So there are defect categories like A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. And the description of the defect is like this. So I checked 150 parts to identify defective parts, actually defective parts, to understand what type of defect it is. So after checking 150, I understood that A type of defects are 70, 12 defects are due to B type, 8 defects are due to C type, then 23, 10, 7, 15, 5. You can also put others, so that generalize one. Now you put percentage, doesn't make much difference, or higher at the top level, and then you reducing defects. So you have now categorized them as an reducing defects. So 70 at the top, then 23, then 15, then 12, 10, 8, etc. So now it has changed the sequence. It is not now A, B, C, D, E. It has now become A, D, G, B, E. So doesn't make a difference whether it is quantity, number of defects, or percentage of defects. Now there is a third column. What you try to write down in a third column is a cumulative percentage of defects. So for the first A, it is 47. So A plus D is 62. Then ADG is 72, 80. That is what is a cumulative defect. Now when you are going for drawing a graph, it is it has two scales. So on the left hand side, you have number of defects, that is on the bar chart, and you have a line chart with an cumulative defects. And if you suppose you draw a line from 80 to 20, 80 se leke you come down. So what does it mean? If you improve or if you eliminate these four defects, you are done. So this is now it is also important. The A category defects are almost 47%. So if you focus only on A and reduce those 47% to the 10%, you are improving your process by 40% almost. So you will also come to know the effect of your work. So that is to understand that which is my major defect is, or major cause is. So this tool is called as an Pareto analysis. which is also called as an 80-20 rule. The punchline is identify vital few out of travel many. So reasons, causes of defect, causes of delay, etc. So the next tool is called as a brainstorming and cause and effect diagram. So the what is brainstorming again? This is now there are two types of tools which are used in analysis, which are quantitative tools or qualitative tools. So stratification, Pareto analysis, or check sheet were quantitative type of tools, while brainstorming and cause and effect is etc. is an qualitative tool. It just generates the idea. So what is brainstorming? Generating the ideas or the potential causes. So you have done this, you can either do it using a process map, or if you want to develop a solution, like we saw bubble at particular place on the door. So you can brainstorm also why bubble on a particular location, or why delays after 8 o'clock in a pizza deliveries. So brainstorming. So brainstorming can be done in any ways. So within a short span, you will try to generate the ideas. So idea here is not to jump on a conclusion, only generate the quantity of potential causes. You can screen those causes using other tools, but if you don't know anything about the process, you are developing any solution on the process, you just generate an ideas. Now, implementing or completing the project is not only a technical aspect or knowing a statistical solution and then implement. The brainstorming is a very important tool which can be used for a consensus building for implementation of your idea. So what is effectiveness? So effectiveness basically in life is a multiplication of two things. One is a quality of idea and acceptability to the idea. Now look at the you have an suppose there is some problem and you are very intelligent, technically very sound, and you came out with a very brilliant idea which is rated 8 on 10 scale, 1 to 10 scale 8, but you don't have an acceptability to that solution, then probably you will not be successful in implementing that idea. So suppose you have an acceptability only to the level of 3 on 1 to 10 scale, your product is 8 into 3, but your idea is so, but it has got a very good acceptability to the scale, maybe 8. So you may land up in score of 40. So how to build up that acceptability? So you may be brilliant, but everybody in your department is not that brilliant and not accept this idea. So the brainstorming and cause and effect diagram or a brainstorming meeting is very useful in building up this consensus for implementing a solution. So when you are brainstorming, whoever involved in brainstorming feels that I am also the part of a solution. And when you are implementing the idea, he also has a feel that, yes, I was also part of the brainstorming and this has come up of our brainstorming and I should be supporting this implementation. That is what is how a soft tool called brainstorming can be effectively used. Of course, it is very useful in generating the ideas also. Okay. So generally what happens in brainstorming? You have a group of people, 8-10 people, and everybody is being asked what you feel, and everybody will speak out only one reason, and there will be so many reasons which will come out in a group of 10. But when you are doing a brainstorming, your group has to be homogeneous. It should not happen that department head or teacher is dominating the brainstorming session. So he only keeps on saying the ideas and other people are listening. So it goes on a round robin method. Every individual will get chance to speak, and he will speak out the idea, and that will be recorded. And as a part, nobody's idea will be marked as stupid, but the entire group will try to build on that idea. That is what is a brainstorming. So there are various methods: round robin method, wildest idea method, or reverse thinking method, or 6-3-5 method for a brainstorming. The idea is to identify or develop the solution, find out the reasons, like that. So once you have brainstorming, it will be converted into effect and cause relationship. It is also called as a fishbone diagram or Ishikawa diagram, because Ishikawa has originated this diagram. So it is also called cause and effect diagram, fishbone diagram, and Ishikawa. All three are same. So how does it work? What is the effect? And once you identify various reasons in brainstorming, those various reasons will be categorized in a different form. So if you have a transactional process, probably it will be categorized in 6P manner. Or if it is a manufacturing environment, probably it will be like 5M and 1P. It is not a hard and fast rule, but this is just a guideline. So in a cause and effect, we categorize what has been identified as during a brainstorming. So what are various reasons of poor housekeeping, machine, method, man, like that. Then it is not hard and fast, like I have to use M only. Now I have a conflict at workplace. So what is the boss related problems? What are the subordinate related problems? What is my problems? What is peer group problems? You can identify that. So once you identify that, then you go for a data collection. So primarily what tool first you have used, you have brainstorm and then cause and effect diagram, and then you go for a data collection. It will be very useful when we will discuss FMEA during next session. So we will take all these reasons to FMEA. So failure mode effect analysis, and where you will understand how you will be using this data. So the next tool is histogram. So I will take 10 more minutes and finish the 7 tools. And then later on during next session, we will take up the other tools. So histogram is a graph that displays the distribution of the data or presenting the variation in the data. So it will tell you, means basically how my data is distributed, and whole of the statistics start with this distribution of the data. So if your data is discrete or continuous, then there are various distributions which are being used: hypergeometric distribution, then normal distribution, etc., etc. So whole of the statistics start from the distribution of the data. So histogram is a best example of how the data is distributed. So histogram tells you about the center, width, and overall shape of the graph distribution. So what are the examples? Height of the adults male in the city. So probably this data will help any garment manufacturer to produce how many 40, how many 42, how many 44, etc. Okay. Weight of the 15-year-old boys in the town. Then marks obtained by 50 students in the match test. So run scored by Virat Kohli in IPL from 2016 to 2020. Many of the times, these histograms are also used to compare who is a better batsman, Tendulkar or a Lara. So based on the distribution of the data or the histograms of the run scored, the judgment or a decision is taken that who is a good batsman and who is a bad batsman, or who is a better batsman rather way. Okay. So it depends on all how the distribution of marks is, how distribution of runs is. So generally it should follow a bell-shaped curve. Bell-shaped curve means centrally located, highest frequency at the center, and then reducing at both the ends. That it should typically be. But if it is deviating from this typical distribution, we will understand that, or we'll come to know why is it that, and we may have some clues to improve the process. That is what is the idea in doing an histogram. So how the histograms are constructed? So you have a data of 12 students in science. So how much is the lowest value, how much is the highest value? Based on that, the intervals are decided and the boundaries of the intervals are decided. So there are rules also, the smallest, highest, and what is the range? That is highest and lowest, I have a range of 67. Now based on that 67, how many intervals I should have? So I should have, there are mathematical formulas also to calculate the intervals. So this is method 1, method 2, method 3. You can use this mathematical formula or guidelines to have intervals. So suppose I am plotting an histogram and I don't have much much intervals. Suppose this example is about number of marks. Number of marks score. So if I have various intervals, I will come to know the distribution. So often continuous data. Suppose I have only two intervals, who scored more than 50 and less than 50. So it becomes a discrete data. So I have only two intervals. So it is like a pass and fail. So who has more than 50 or who has less than 50. So when I have less number of intervals, my information gets reduce, or I will get less information. That is why it is very important to have an optimum number of intervals. So that is the guideline of how many intervals I should have. So based on that, you have decided how much will be the interval width, and based on that you will just have a frequency distribution or filling up the frequency. So how many students have scored between 10, 20 to 29, 30 to 29, etc. And then you plot a bar graph. Now, if you look on your graph, you will find there is a mean and median which are different. So when a mean and median are different, when your data is not a perfectly bell-shaped curve, your mean and median are different. Now, the fundamentally very important question or important aspect is whether to consider mean or median. So if your data is generally, when we talk about the average marks, we talk about the average production, we talk everything about the average. Unknowingly, we assume that my data is normal. But if your data is not normal, then your median is in the right representation. So you must be representing median of your data set. Why median? Because it is perfectly middle figure. Aadhe udhar gaye, aadhe idhar gaye, beech mein reh gaya wo median. So the median is in the right representation. If you look at the HR guys, now aap logon ka HR walon se itna palla nahi pada hoga abhi tak, because you are just in your academic career. But HR people will always, now abhi placement ke time hoga aapka, but if you listen to the HR guys, they will always talk about the median salary. So they don't talk about the average salary, they always talk about the median salary in this category, or median salary in this category, or median salary of this grade, etc., etc. So why? Because they do not know whether we can consider mean only if our data is normal. And if our data is normal, the mean will be same as median. But if the mean is not the same as median, then it is always better to consider median as an reference point, not a mean. That is what we come to know from a histogram. So there can be a various shapes. So you can say on your left top corner, it is called a double peak. So what is a double peak mean? There are two processes within one process. Means when I am saying my average production is 80, I have two machines. One is producing 90 and one is producing 70. That is what is this mean. So when I want to, if I want to improve, I have to focus on the performance of the machine, which is not producing well. Okay, then comb shape or data with the outliers. So if you see a figure right corner, you see outliers. So if you want to improve again, I told you about the two tactics to improve a process. So identify outliers and saturate those outliers. It will improve your average. So the histograms gives you the outliers, and you can identify those outliers using a histogram. So next tool is about the graphs charts. So it only represents or presents. So there are various types of charts or graphs being used. So this is the line graph we often see during our cricket matches. Then there is a bar graph. Again, this is an presentation or an information. Bar graph, then pillar graph, it is called as. Then this is something different. This is the belt graph. So the split up in the bar graph. So you can identify on the number of programs which are done and where it has been done. So you can see in house there is a remarkable improvement or increase in red. So this is again stratification in a bar graph. Okay. So the overlapping of a tool, stratification in a bar graph. Pie chart, you people commonly use this using Excel. So this is a compound, the Pareto graph, which is also called as a compound graph. This is a radar chart. Basically, it is on a 360 scale. It's a round scale, and we map before and after. So how much was my before score and how much was my after score? So based on that, I come to know that where I improved more or where the improvement was not that good, and I have to improve that area like that. Then there is a scatter plots, that is X and Y. So what is X and Y? So it is when you are both X and Y continuous, they just give you the relationship. This is a visual picture of your X and Y relationship. We quantify this relationship going ahead, which is called as a correlation analysis. So here we end with 7 QC tools. We will take up new 7 QC tools and few more tools during our next session. So any questions? I have already overshooted by 10 minutes.
No, sir.
So if there are any questions, you can ask more.
Hello.
Hello.
Any questions? If